B-Link's got quite a few mini PCs that are on the way due to be released. This model here that I've got that they sent out to me is their GTI 11. The 11 because it's an 11th gen model here. This one is powered by the Core i5-1135G7. It has Iris Xe graphics, 4 cores, maximum turbo is 4.2 gigahertz. Now this configuration is paired up with 16 gigabytes of RAM and dual channel, DDR4 spec, 3.2 gigahertz. It has a 512 gigabyte SSD, which is an NVMe one, but there is room to install another SSD, SATA 3 spec, and even a 2.5 inch drive bay, even though it's quite a small little chassis here, the build of it. So it does have a fingerprint reader. It's got Intel's wireless AX201 as our wireless chipset, so Wi-Fi 6 support with Bluetooth 5.2, and it does also have gigabit LAN and 2.5 gigabit LAN ports on there, so two of them. Inside the box, we do get a 51 watt power supply with this, a short HDMI cable, then a standard size HDMI cable, a VESA mounting bracket, and some screws for it, and then some screws for a SATA 3 2.5 inch drive. There is also a user manual which is in various different languages, and it just goes over the basic operation of it and lets us know what all the ports do. Looking at the design and build of this one now, so around the outside is metal, there's plastic on the top, nice finish, and we have a fingerprint reader here for Windows Hello. Instead of passwords, you can simply just touch this. Of course, if you're going to be mounting this behind a monitor, then you won't be using that there, but at least it's an option we do have. Core i5 sticker, and looking at our ports here at the front. So we've got two USB 3 ports, 3.5 millimeter with headphone jack support, and then a Type-C port. Now this Type-C port, I've tested it, 4K, 60 frames per second, 60 hertz is what is possible out of that one there. Data, but it does not support power delivery at all there. And we've got our power button with a status LED below it, and then our clear CMOS, and you'll see why later on. It's because the BIOS is fully unlocked to us. If you mess up any of those settings, you can simply reset it by pressing that, which is quite good there. Now, either side, we have GI5 here, and that's because it's the Core i5 that it has. So this is a vent. You'll see there, again, there's the other one. And then the back of it with our ports here, we've got quite a bit. This is where the cooler is, so this is all the hot air is going to be blowing out of this top part right here. Two USB 3s, two USB 2s, DisplayPort 1.4, HDMI 2.0, so that supports 4K 60. Now it looks like it could run 4K 120 Hz with my LG CX, but when it goes onto that higher refresh rate, it simply cuts out, so I don't think it's going to support it there. Now we do have gigabit LAN and 2.5 gigabit LAN there, which is good. And then DC in here for charging. And finally, along the bottom, we've got these two mounting points there for the VESA bracket, so you can put it behind a TV or a monitor. But let's have a look now at the internals. There's just four screws here to remove to gain access. Hey, well, the internals, there is some good news that I do like, that they've used a large thermal pad. Look how thick that thing is on top of our PCIe 3.0 SSD there. It's a Kingston one. Now we do have our wireless card, which is the Intel AX201. You can see just near my thumb there on the left. That's soldered onto the motherboard, so no upgrades there. The RAM, so this one comes pre-installed with 16 gigabytes of DDR4 RAM. You can easily upgrade this, and it is in dual channel. Then our 2.5 inch drive, that is where it will go installed onto the bottom of it. That boot drive, which is our 512 gigabyte PCIe NVMe drive, is a Kingston there, an A2000. You can see that we do have this, a secondary slot there for another 22 by 80 sized SATA 3 SSD only in that one. So it's just this one that supports NVMe. First up, the BIOS. So this one is completely unlocked. You probably thought it would be because they give us that clear CMOS button on the front of it, right? So if you mess up any of the settings, that's what you have to use. So we do have access to all of our power limit settings. For example, overclocking performance menu, you can go and undervolt, tweak, and do all those kind of things if you want to do so. All right, so you can go into processor right here. And if you know that you're able to undervolt, then you're able to do that if it's stable. But probably test it out first with Intel's extreme tuning utility. Well, that's what I would do before setting it at a BIOS level, but it's easy enough just to reset it. So we've got more tweaks in here, including RAM, for example, if you wanted to tweak that to see if you could get it
a little bit better, those timings that the performance could be slightly faster, you can do that as well in here. So fully featured BIOS, really good to see, and one of the pros of these B-Link mini PCs. So I'll go over into Windows now. Now this PC does come with Windows 10 Pro, so not Windows 11. However, it does support it and you can freely upgrade it, no additional cost. You just simply need to download it, run all the updates, and you'll be on Windows 11 then. So it does support it. When you go to check, you can see it's got everything that it does need. Of course, this having an 11th gen processor, TPM 2.0, it's got that secure boot and enough RAM and storage space. So not an issue there to run Windows 11 on this. Or you could just keep Windows 10 if you want to. So the disk drive that I showed you is that Kingston one, and it's PCIe 3.0. The speeds on it, they're fine. It's definitely a lot faster than SATA 3, which is the main thing here, but certainly not the fastest I've seen for a PCIe NVMe drive there. It could be a lot quicker if you had like a Samsung drive there, but it's good. It's still good there, so don't get me wrong. So with our processor here, it is the Core i5-1135G7. The important thing about this one is it does have the Iris Xe graphics. It's a 28 watt part, 10 nanometers. The maximum turbo is 4.2 gigahertz. Now you do see it listed here 8 times because it is multi-threaded. So we have 4 cores, but 8 threads in total. Now with our wireless chip, this is one I showed you when we looked at the internals. You can't upgrade it. Not that you would probably want to. It's a very good chip. So I get about 1.3 gigabits per second transfers, and it does have Bluetooth 5.2, which is great there. And you can see our fingerprint reader. So instead of typing passwords, you could use that to log into Windows using Windows Hello. Now, other things to point out, let's get onto the Geekbench. Now I'm going to test that. The single core score is just over 1400 points. That's good. And their multi-core score for a quad core, again, is good there. That's excellent score, just over 5000. So it is a fast mini PC. And general kind of workloads I'll get onto now. General kind of computing like spreadsheets, documents, all very quick. Video playback, so HEVC VP9 support. And this is a 4K 10-bit file, HEVC, 140 megabits per second. And it plays it just fine. It does not drop any frames at all. So Iris Xe graphics handles video files, even really demanding ones, without any problem at all. It's all flawless. I'll just skip ahead there, and you can see that that is not dropping any frames. That one's 60 frames per second. So really good when it comes to video performance here. It'll just play everything. Taking a quick look now at 4K video playback performance. So this should be fine because it's a powerful enough chip to be able to handle this. So enabling the stats here, we can see that we've got zero dropped frames and it is streaming this in 4K with YouTube. Not an issue. This is in Chrome too, by the way. So it's not an Edge. Edge is even better than performance. So it's quite capable of this. This is a very light task for Iris Xe graphics. Now this Core i5-1135G7 with the Iris Xe graphics can handle video editing in 4K with demanding applications like this one, Adobe Premiere Pro. So I will export this file and let you know just how long it's going to take. It's a typical test that I do with these mini PCs to see just how good are they at this. Now normally this kind of spec should be able to do this within about 1 minute. Now, that was pretty laggy just then for some reason. So I will just get a minute of footage and I'll skip ahead and I'll show you how long it's going to take to encode that at 4K. And it looks like it is going to be just under 1 minute. So approximately 55 seconds. That's really good performance. So it's capable. It can handle 4K light video editing. Anything that's really demanding with lots of layers and things, you really do need still a dedicated GPU for that, of course. Gaming performance now. So GTA 5 looking very good. This is around 70 frames per second on average. But of course, when I get into the street with more cars to render, you can see now it's dropping down. Okay, so about 50, but this is still very good considering it's all integrated graphics. So 1080p. Now I have not got it on the lowest possible settings. What I'm running is in between. So view distance and the density of the population, everything like that, is all on the middle kind of settings. So you could say, yeah, basically medium settings here, looking very good. So what I do now is test out a few other titles and what kind of gaming performance you could expect from a tiny little mini PC like this. And then I'll check on those thermals, which are three performance. So this game can get around and over 50 frames per second, sometimes up to 60, but I do have it set to 720p. However, this performance is really good considering that, okay, yeah, it's an old game, but it's a demanding game, and this is certainly a very playable frame rate. What I'll do now is just test it at 1080p and see if that's still going to be playable. This is looking good. We're scraping just over 30 frames per second, so you could say it's similar performance to playing this on, say, a console, really, that will be capped out at 1080p, 30 frames per second. It's not ideal, but it is possible, and it still looks all right. I don't know if I could happily play, though, at 37 frames per second in the towns here. I really want that 60, so me personally, I'd run this game at 720p. And lastly, Shadow of the Tomb Raider. So this game still is quite a demanding game here. So I've got it set to 720p on the lowest visual settings. And we can see looking around, there's a bit of screen tearing going on. So really don't want to run it at 1080p because it will be a little bit too laggy, I feel, because it's already at 45 here, which isn't great. Cinebench R23 scores now. So the single core score here, I was expecting maybe about 100 points more than this. So it's okay, not too bad. And the multi-core score there, not too bad either. That's off somewhere of where a Core i7-7700K would be. So it's not too bad considering it's a quad core and a 28 watt processor. I think it does well there performance wise. So what about the thermals then? Is it getting a little too hot? Is it thermal throttling? It's actually pretty good. Look at this. So 83 degrees Celsius. This involves me gaming on it, stress testing the benchmarks that I've done. So that's not a bad result at all. However, yes, the fan, you do hear the fan a little bit. I'll give you a sample of what it's like under full load. And it does cycle on and off now and then, which can be a little bit annoying. Linux support here, so I did a very quick test there just to boot it up and check a few things, and what I could not connect to was my wireless. For some reason, it's not detecting the AX201, which is really odd because this Linux Mint distro that I test out on other mini PCs, it hasn't had a problem with the AX200 or the 201. So a bit of troubleshooting there. Probably I need to try out some other distros out there, some other builds, and see if it's going to work or not. But it's just a little minor setback here. Linux should actually work just fine on this.
Now we do have a really good mini PC, I feel, from B-Link with this one. It's got a lot of options there. You can install more storage, so you could add another 2 terabyte 2.5 inch drive, another 2 terabyte 22x80mm M.2, as long as it's SATA 3, and then you've got your fast boot drive. So plenty of options there. Type-C port, so video out. It can run 3 monitors with a DisplayPort HDMI and that Type-C port. That's also great. 2 LAN ports on here, so more options there as well. And it does have plenty of USB ports on this. The other thing I like about it, well, is the performance. Is Iris Xe graphics means that it can even handle a bit of light 4K video editing, light gaming. Older titles like GTA 5 at 1080p on medium settings had a very playable frame rate, so that's great to see. There is really only one con with this particular unit here for me, and that is the fan noise. And I wouldn't say it's a deal breaker either, but it does make a little bit of noise. So the thermals, they are good, they check out. There's no thermal throttling, it doesn't get too hot. It's just that the fan noise, when you really push it hard, you'll hear it. And sometimes the fan cycles on and off, or it's on a lower RPM, steps up to the higher one, and literally 30 seconds later, it'll drop down again. So you can hear that sometimes, especially if you've got this mini PC just sitting right in front of, say, your monitor there. If you've got it behind the monitor, you're away from that fan noise, and it won't really be so bad. But it is minor, but it's just the fan noise. That is really it, the only con with this particular system here, so do like it. Now, I will have more up-and-coming mini PC reviews, some more models here from B-Link, so make sure you're tuned for those, and I do hope to see you in the next one. Bye for now.